Thank you very much, and thank you all for coming out this evening. And a huge thanks to the library in the round, not only for enabling me to come in and talk to you this evening, but actually for granting me access to the materials that form the core of at least a third of the book. The architecture of the book is kind of interesting, I think, in that it starts with King's visit, without which there's no, you know, that's the rationale for the book. And then actually at the end of the material on the visit, it vaults back to try to put King's appearance in Newcastle in 1967 in a much longer history of connections between the Northeast, specifically Tyneside, and the African-American freedom struggle, which stretches back into the late 18th and early and through the 19th centuries, and features visits by many, many African-American fugitive slaves, perhaps most eminent among them Frederick Douglass, who came here on four occasions and was the preeminent black abolitionist of the 19th century. And of course, if you listen to the current incumbent of the White House in the United States, he still believes he's alive and doing a good job, which is somewhat sobering thought. So what I wanted to do was to put King's visit, to make it less anomalous, to actually put it into the context of something that the sociologist Dave Renton calls the cultures of welcome that have emerged in the Northeast, which actually are embodied in Newcastle's current status as a city of sanctuary. So lots of peoples have come through Newcastle and found a warm welcome. Some people have found a less than warm welcome, and I talk about that in the book too, because I think it does a disservice to the history to sweep under the rug various incidents and outbreaks of racial, religious, and ethnic intolerance. However, the bottom line is that there are very durable cultures of welcome in the Northeast that Martin Luther King's visit forms a connection to. And, you know, as I mentioned, the abolitionists of the 19th century, you get King in the mid 20th century, and you get Muhammad Ali afterwards, and you get Harry Belafonte in the 1990s. There's a very, very long tradition of African Americans of eminence who've been involved in various kinds of civil rights, human rights struggles coming through Newcastle and getting a warm reception here. And so King's visit fits into that storyline. But what I wanted to do this evening is really to talk you through some of the documents that you can see upstairs. Kim, you should clear your desktop. Some of the materials that you can see in the exhibition upstairs, most of which come from the collections of the university, some of which were kindly donated for use by Peter Kane and by Peter O'Donnell, and I'll talk about those in due course. And, you know, in doing the research for this book, those finds were among my most favorite and most memorable occurrences. So I'll keep it tight to the university, but I did want to have that little preamble to say that actually this is a visit that speaks to race relations in the northeast of England, and as someone who's a civil rights historian, primarily, tells us something about the international resonance of the African-American freedom struggle. And I can take questions on that in due course. But onto the particulars of the visit. I'm going to talk about three things, really. The visit itself, the circumstances, the arrangements that were made. Say a little bit about the speech that King gave, and something about the legacies, the acts of remembering and forgetting King's visit. Because I think that's quite important too. By the time Muhammad Ali came, just one decade after King was here, no one bothered to tell or knew to tell Muhammad Ali that Martin Luther King had been here. When Jimmy Carter came through, no one knew or bothered to tell Jimmy Carter that one of his heroes, Martin Luther King, had been in the same place a decade before. There are acts of remembrance and there are acts of forgetting that take place in this story. And of course, it has a happy ending of sorts in the sense that Freedom City finally in 2017 delivers the sort of commemoration that King's visit warrants, and acts as a moment to rededicate ourselves to some of the challenges and to confront some of the problems that King identified back in 1967, many of which are scarily very current today. So this is one of the documents that you can see upstairs, and this is the first official press release from the university announcing publicly for the first time that Martin Luther King is going to be coming to collect a DCL, a doctorate in civil law, in the King's Hall in the Armstrong Building of the University in November. A special congregation has been arranged for this. Of course, behind this has been the best part of 5 months of correspondence backwards and forwards across the Atlantic. The initial nomination of King for an honorary doctorate, which is, of course, as you know, the process for nominating honorary doctorates is extremely confidential, but it was Lord Wynne Jones, let me tell you that, who did that. He was a Labour peer, someone who was interested in social justice in the round. But the main mover and shaker, perhaps, behind the decision to invite King was the gentleman you see looking over his shoulder, somewhat hawkishly, I think, Charles Bosanquet, the first Vice Chancellor of Newcastle University. And he was very keen that honorary doctorates be used as a vehicle, as a mechanism, as an instrument for branding the university as a university that had a civic mission, that wanted to be involved in the major social issues of the day. And that's quite interesting. We think about branding and corporate branding as being something that's rather new to the university sector. Bosanquet clearly wanted to align the university with these social issues of the day to give it an appearance and, in fact, a reality of interest in the great affairs of the day. I think that need was infinitely more urgent for Bosanquet in 1966/67 because the university occupied a kind of strange liminal position. It was simultaneously perceived as a new and an old university. It only got its independence, if you like, from Durham in 1963. So in some ways it was considered a new university, yet because of the connection with Durham, the third oldest university, I guess, in England, because of that connection, it was still sometimes thought of as an old university. You also have something of a paradox in that, remember, this is the 1960s, student radicalism, student activism on campuses throughout Britain is extremely vibrant around issues to do with race, but also to do with gender, to do with the Vietnam War, and to do with policies in South Africa. There's a lot of student activism, but not in Newcastle. So we have this strange situation where the Vice Chancellor, who one might expect to be trying to quell radical students, is actually saying, let's bring someone like King to campus, because that might actually motivate people to become more socially, more involved in social activism. So it's a kind of strange phenomenon. Now, those of you who work in universities and university administration, cover your ears now, because this is the official press release, which has about 73 mistakes regarding who Martin Luther King is and who and where he lives. Just have a little look at this. This is Martin Luther King Jr., gets a PhD from Boston, should have just stopped there. Everything up to that point is fine. He's apparently the pastor of Baptist Church, Alabama, USA. Have you any idea how many Baptist churches there are in Alabama? And by the way, Alabama is a state, not a town or a city. He was actually, for a while, the pastor of the Dexter Avenue Baptist Church in Montgomery, Alabama. And it says there since 1954. That's kind of true, except for he'd left to take over the co-pastorate of Ebenezer Baptist Church in Atlanta in 1960 to work with his father. This created all kinds of chaos as arrangements were trying to be made between the university here and King's people in America, because they routinely sent the letters to the wrong address. Sometimes they were forwarded, but there comes a point in the correspondence, which I found hilarious, where the good people of Montgomery, Alabama, are just fed up with this stuff coming from the northeast of England and send it back to the university saying, with a sort of returned, moved on or something. On the envelope. So it takes a while for the arrangements to actually, the lines of communication to be actually firmed up. So there's a lot of to-ing and fro-ing around this. You'll see also as well, he's noted as the founder and leader of the Southern Christian Leadership Council. Well, that was actually called the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, but now I'm getting picky. And he did indeed win the Nobel Peace Prize in 1964, so that at least was accurate as well. What I also like is the fact that, it's given prominence in this press release. It is at the top, But you'll note with some interest that there was a symposium going on liquid extractions in the Department of Chemical Engineering, and that one of the university's landscape architects was going to visit the USA to deliver a special lecture. I think it's kind of interesting the way it gets rolled into, and there's loads of this other really interesting stuff. And by the way, Dr. Martin Luther King's going to come over and get an honorary doctorate at some point. I like the fact that it's sort of part of the routine, if you like, of the university. Introduce you to two of the secret heroes of this whole story. On the left, Ernest Bettinson, who's the registrar who spent all his time writing to the wrong address in Montgomery, but sticks with it until finally he gets a line of communication into King sorted out. And George Howe, who was chief clerk of the university. George Howe, you know, he's a real belts and braces man. He leaves nothing to chance on the day of the visit. He's the one who makes sure that in the King's Hall, the carpet looks nice, the dais is good, you know, everything's polished and spick and span. He's the one who sends letters round to all the heads of departments explaining exactly what's going on. And by the way, do not do anything noisy in the quadrangle. He suspends construction work so that there's no disruption to the ceremony. He's someone who's got a finger in every aspect of the visit, the actual protocols and the technicalities of the visit. He's the one who cares that someone from Georgia is going to be able to survive in Newcastle's temperatures. You know, they're coming in November. He's the one who sorts out that there's going to be umbrellas ready, that the temperature in the King's Hall is exactly the same as it might be in Atlanta. Of course, King's actually flown from Chicago, so curiously, Newcastle's actually slightly warmer in November. But, you know, you can't fault the guy for his efforts to make sure King is looked after and is comfortable at every step of the way. He'll also, as you'll see, be crucial in me discovering the film of King speaking. You know, his notes are valuable in that respect. This telegram here is the first sign Bettison gets that King has actually got a clue. They're trying to get him to the university. It's a telegram. You can see it's dated in February of 1967, where he says, you know, sorry, I can't come there in May, because originally the invitation was to come and be part of a regular degree ceremony, but that he's more than happy to come in November. And after that, I have to say, planning, you know, begins to go relatively smoothly. Lots of the arrangements are made in terms of buying tickets and the like, until there's a kind of a curveball thrown by the police and the judicial system in Alabama. Because on the 30th of October, which is barely 2 weeks before King's due to come over to accept the award, King is jailed in Bessemer, Alabama. And the jailing is related to events that took place in the very celebrated 1963 protests in Birmingham, Alabama. And King has been going through various appeals processes for the intervening 4 years. And he's exhausted all legal remedies and he has to go to jail because essentially he violated a stipulation in a probation that he had, which said, thou shalt not march. And so he goes to jail. Now, King had been jailed dozens of times before, but this is the first time that news of his incarceration had ever sent shockwaves through the catering department of Newcastle University. Because basically there were people who were desperately trying to sort out the visit and didn't know how, you know, they assumed that he would be coming. They were ordering to do the catering accordingly. There was going to be receptions, there was going to be a dinner, there was going to all this stuff. And so plans are thrown into chaos. King is jailed, he's released from jail, there's a correspondence which confirms that he will be coming, but the Chancellor of the University, the Duke of Northumberland, up in Alnwick Castle, who's going to come and preside over the ceremony, he's less sure that King is actually going to show up. And I love this letter. I shall attend the reception and lunch as well as the congregation on Monday the 13th. That is assuming Dr. King has been released from jail. So he's hedging his bets a little bit, and I love the fact he signs it just Northumberland. And, you know, as you can see, they seem to have struck up at least some kind of conviviality during the course of the ceremony. There are some lovely shots. I mean, and obviously our understanding of this visit is colored by the fact that we know 6 months later King's dead. Okay. And I think that makes it, you know, all that more poignant. It is the only visit he ever makes outside of London. He comes to England 6 times. It's the only time he leaves London, and one of the things I do in the book is try to explain why that's the case, why he bothers to come at all. But it's also his last time he gives a public oration outside of North America as well. So it's a very poignant moment. But I think when you look at some of these photographs, there seems to be signs of real joy and relief, especially as his profile in the United States during this period is not altogether positive. I think we think of King as an icon, as someone who's sort of untouchable in some ways, and that's to obscure the fact that he was much reviled and much hated in America in 1967 and 68, partly because of his increasingly radical politics, partly because of his opposition to the war in Vietnam. And in the African-American civil rights movement, he's sort of caught in a pincer movement between black radicals, Black Panthers, Black Power activists, who think he's way too moderate, and more moderate black leaders who think, why are you still agitating for more reforms, more change? Why are you getting involved in American foreign policy and alienating the White House? So he's caught in this sort of vice-like grip inside the black freedom struggle as well. I think one of the reasons he comes to Newcastle is he's really, really interested in coming to a place that it respects and admires the work he's already done and believes he's still capable of providing leadership. What happens on the day itself? Well, someone here should recognize this gentleman. Gentleman here is Lawrence Kane, and Lawrence's son Peter is here today. And one of the things, King arrives on the into London on the afternoon, late morning of Sunday the 12th of November 1967. He goes to the Hilton Hotel, he picks up some train tickets, has a sleep, and gets the overnight train with Andrew Young, his colleague, to Newcastle. They sit on the platform at Central Station for a couple of hours, and then they're collected and taken to the Vice Chancellor's residence, which is where Lawrence Kane, Edna Kane, his wife, and family also live with the Vice Chancellor and his wife Barbara Bosanquet as well. And they freshen up, they have breakfast, and clearly this breakfast is of such stunning quality that he makes a gesture and signs an autograph for Barbara Bosanquet and for Edna Kane. But he also, and this is such a great find, and so grateful to Peter Kane, he leaves his dress handkerchief unused. The one that he was going to use, he had planned to use in his suit jacket. He leaves that as a gesture of thanks for the hospitality he's received. And you can see that upstairs in the flesh, as it were. They then go off into the university, and one of the things that is arranged is a meeting with students at 11 o'clock in the morning. And some of these candid photographs, you know, some of the best informal shots of the day were taken by the gentleman on the left, Paul Barry, who is the reporter, photographer for the Courier, for the student newspaper. And, you know, you can see him rocking some quintessential 1967 mutton chops there, just to authenticate, his status. One of the interesting things here is it's one of the only shots of Andrew Young in the university. And Andrew Young's presence, I talk about this quite a lot in the book, is sort of something of a mystery to many of the people who were at the event. The Vice Chancellor initially had extended an invitation to Coretta Scott King, Martin's wife, to come. That wasn't going to happen. Comes with Andrew Young instead, who's a lieutenant of his in the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, and of course goes on to become mayor of Atlanta and Jimmy Carter's ambassador to the UN. So he's a distinguished civil rights leader in his own right. The Vice Chancellor at various times thinks that he's Martin Luther King's son, which is tricky. There's about 3 weeks between them in terms of birth. And at various other times he thinks he might be his brother, but ultimately he does work out who he is. But for assembled guests, some people called him his secretary, and some people thought he was his bodyguard. And that raises one of the most interesting things about the whole visit, which was the security arrangements. Now, as far as I can work out, there's two policemen, only one of which is there the whole time, And basically a whole bunch of people like porters, the other administrators are pressed into duty to actually marshal, as they do at graduation ceremonies, the event. It's unbelievable how little security there was there. But various people who were there on the day have talked about how they remember King having a black bodyguard or bodyguards. And I'm just wondering if they just misunderstood who Andrew Young was. Now, it's not inconceivable that King picked up a security detail from London, from the US Embassy, or from Special Branch, or whatever. So I haven't dismissed that. But the correspondence is voluminous, particularly from George Howe, about the arrangements. And George Howe has something way better than the FBI, the CIA, or Special Branch. He has Mrs. Kell. Now, Mrs. Kell is available to do security. And as you can see from this letter there, Mrs. Kell will be on duty. She's to keep an eye open for undesirable characters with toilet rolls and or soft fruit. So clearly they think there is a major threat to King's well-being from essentially from Granger Market, as far as I can discern. There is nothing more than I've already articulated about security. Now, frankly, if you are Special Branch or FBI, you're supposed to be not seen on camera. You're not supposed to be photographed. So as I say, I'm not dismissing entirely the possibility that there was a secret detail, but nothing has emerged either from the Atlanta end or from the Newcastle end to suggest there was anything more than the policeman that I mentioned. King comes, he gets his degree, and although the security folks are encouraged to discourage any unnecessary noise and any unwanted shouting out, in fact, the only unscheduled voice that's heard that day is Martin Luther King's, because he's not supposed to give a speech. I'll talk about that in due course. And he finishes the degree ceremony, gives his speech, has a quick word with the press, and then he's on the 4:06 out of Newcastle back down to London and flies out the next day. He spends 11 hours in Newcastle, only 8 of them awake. It's a very tiny, tiny, tiny period of time that he spends here. But this letter back after he gets home to Bosanquet, I think speaks volumes about why he bothered to fit this into a brutal schedule when he wasn't particularly well, just out of jail. And he talks about how he so appreciates the recognition by an institution of higher learning of the historic significance of one's work in the ministry, calling it a tremendous encouragement, far overshadowing the barbs and arrows from the daily press. And I've seen lots of these letters of thanks from King, who was routinely invited to give talks and accept awards. And this is as poignant as any I've seen. He clearly is feeling under pressure from, you know, the barbs and arrows of the daily press. He's at some level despairing about his own ability to provide leadership. And the book he's writing when the invitation from Newcastle comes is called Where Do We Go From Here? There is a sense of uncertainty. I think that's why he accepts this hugely inconvenient invitation to go to a city he's never heard of at an institution he knows nothing about. I also think he wanted to go to Edinburgh. I think in the initial plans and some of the correspondence, he talks a lot about staying 3 days in Newcastle, much longer, and then going up to Edinburgh afterwards for a break. But this all gets bent out of shape because of his commitments at home. Okay? So Newcastle University, quite rightly, takes great pride in being the only institution in Britain to have awarded King an honorary doctorate during his lifetime. And that's, you know, the road to Freedom City starts with that decision. A few other things I want to talk about. The speech. Now, King was not expected to speak. There's a lot of correspondence between Bosanquet and Bettinson and the King's people in Atlanta saying he's not going to be expected to speak. No, of course he's not. But Bosanquet felt obliged to at least open up the opportunity for King to speak. And he dutifully gives this amazing speech at the end of the ceremony. And Bosanquet, in his report, his annual report the following year, by which time King is dead, says it's such a regret that because we didn't expect him to speak, no provision, no arrangements were made to record the speech. And this was the university's line all the way through the 60s, 70s, 80s, and into the early 90s. Okay? Anyone interested in King's visit was told to go and read the Guardian's coverage of the visit, because actually one of their print journalists had written down fairly extensive notes of what King said. Similarly, the Chronicle, the Journal, and the Courier actually had coverage of the speech. But there are clues. This is how good a historian I am. When I found, we got interested in this story, I asked if there were any pictures, and indeed there were. They were housed at the Audiovisual Centre, which was then inside the medical school. And I walked over there, and I thought to myself, hang on a minute, what's this here? It's a bundle of wires from someone who's clearly tape recording, and this looks suspiciously like some kind of movie camera. And then, I got hold of George Howe's handwritten notes. 10 a.m. on that Monday, he was in there sorting out TV, arrangements for the TV to come in. So there's a paper trail and a visual trail suggesting that indeed King's speech was recorded. And in the fullness of time, this was a much more recent addition to my research, again, thanks to Peter Kane. This is his father's diary. Confirmation that good having degree ceremony seen on Tyne T's television. Okay, what had happened is Tyne T's, and we now believe the BBC had also come in and had filmed King's, or sections of the ceremony, and certainly some of King's speech. On Tyne T's side, it was broadcast on a program called 6.05 and on the evening of the 13th, which I think is quite interesting. The host of 6.05 was a man called Clyde Allain, from Trinidad and Tobago, the first coloured newscaster to be hired in Britain on a permanent contract was actually on Tyne T's television. And he interviews King off to one side of the Armstrong building in a classroom. And we've got a little snippet of that that footage as well. Now, I won't stop to play you the any of the film. It's available on the Freedom City website, and I urge you to listen to it. We have 9 minutes, roughly, of King speaking. He spoke for nearly 30 minutes. So we don't know everything he said. But if you piece together the things that are uttered, the words that are uttered on film, with the coverage in the Courier, the Guardian, and the local newspapers, you can put together the gist of things that we don't have surviving footage of. And clearly, he was talking a lot about British race relations. This is an era in the 1960s of increased immigration from what's euphemistically known as the New Commonwealth, which is a euphemism for the non-white Commonwealth. There's anxieties around whether there should be increased legislation to protect minority rights from the effects of discrimination and bigotry and prejudice. And of course, there's another camp saying we should put up the walls and end immigration, or go further and repatriate peoples from, you know, India or Pakistan or the Caribbean. Okay, so this is a very fraught moment in British race relations. And those debates are current in the Northeast, which we think of as a very white part of the world. Northeast in Newcastle in 1967 had less than 2% immigrants of color. But yet it's a live issue. And when Enoch Powell speaks in the aftermath of King's assassination in April of 1968, there's an outpouring of Powellism, which is confronted by an outpouring of people of goodwill to confront it. But it would be foolish to pretend that these aren't live issues. And that's why I think King talks a lot about British race relations while he's here. And if I was a film, news magazine editor, and I was thinking which bits of King's speech would I cut out and play in the evening, it would be the bits that were most resonant for a British, especially a Northeast audience. So I think that's why we don't have those bits. They were used and probably discarded, though we're always hopeful that they may show up again. Now, I've already mentioned several times that King was shot and killed in Memphis, Tennessee on the 4th of April 1968. And that brings us to the remembering and forgetting. There is a huge outpouring of grief in Newcastle and on Tyneside when King is killed. It's front page news, as it is in most provincial newspapers and national newspapers. But Newcastle's press follows the hunt for King's assassin, James Earl Ray, which ends in London, much longer, and his trial much more assiduously than most provincial newspapers. The university flies its flag in at half mast, and there's a memorial service organised for the university's church at the Haymarket in St Thomas's, and there are various schemes put together to try to honour King, the most eminent and the most recent of the university's honorary graduates. Meanwhile, Peter O'Donnell, who we see here at the back, is so moved by King's assassination that he writes a letter of condolence to Coretta Scott King, expecting to hear nothing back. But in fact, and this is another jewel in the crown of the exhibition upstairs, Peter actually got a card back from Coretta Scott King, which he kept very, very diligently, and we're delighted to be able to reproduce it in the book and also for you to see it upstairs. And of course, King got expressions of sympathy from throughout the world, or the King family from throughout the world. The university, meanwhile, is thinking of things to do to honour him. There's talk of a plaque, there's talk of a bursary in his name, there's a lecture series, the Martin Luther King lecture series, which does start up eventually. And you can see, I think, the council minutes which authorised the upstairs, which authorised the establishment of an honorary, of a series of lectures in King's honour. But it's somewhat fitful, let's put it that way, the celebration. And one of the things, sort of as a scholar, I was interested in was why did this recede from public memory during the 60s, late 60s, 70s, 80s, and counting, the fact the King had ever been here. And there are various reasons. One is, I think, statuary, naming streets, naming buildings, which was one of the proposals. The Claremont Road Bridge building was supposed to be named after King. These sorts of things would help to embed memory of King's visit in public consciousness. The other thing I think that's problematic, and it's not Newcastle's fault, the university's fault by any means, but it was a university event. He arrives at the station, he's whisked to the Vice Chancellor's house, he's then whisked onto campus. There are probably two people of colour who are actually attending any of the events that King is at. So none of the local community, sort of migrant, immigrant communities, who might have been most interested and vested in preserving memory of King's visit and what he stood for, they're not part of this scene. It's a very cloistered, on-campus event. And I think that's one of the reasons why it doesn't enter popular consciousness in the way that Jimmy Carter standing outside the the Civic Center in front of 200,000 people or whatever and touring the Northeast and saying, "Hawaii the lads," or Muhammad Ali on a bus going through throwing South Shields and whatever. These are public events. These are something that have mass participation. So I think that's one of the reasons why perhaps King, we struggled to memorialize King's visit. Of course, the other thing was until 1992-93, there was no film. The best you had was a few shots, still shots. There was no footage, whereas Carter and Muhammad Ali's visits are well seen. There were some attempts. This extraordinarily good-looking bloke on the right of the top shot organised a memorial conference next to Professor Tony Badger. You'll see there of these parts. My predecessor at Newcastle as a historian of the American South and civil rights. On Tony's, so I guess, on the far left is James Wright, the Vice Chancellor of the University, who was extraordinarily interested in King's visit, especially once there was a film, that he could see. And Doug Marlett, the late cartoonist, Pulitzer-winning cartoonist, who won Pulitzer Prizes for his cartoons on race in America. And then down below, Jerry Patterson, the then dean of the Faculty of Arts, I think it was. Julian Bond, in the brown jacket, the late Julian Bond, a very eminent civil rights leader who fell in love with Newcastle on this visit and came back again in 1998. And J. Kenneth Blackwell, a black conservative, a Republican, mayor of Cincinnati. They all gave public lectures. There was an outreach element into the city. The Discovery Museum ran exhibits of Marlett's cartoons and photography about race in the West End of Newcastle. These were public-facing events as well as having an academic component. And so, in retrospect, I'm very proud of this event, though extremely embarrassed by the tie. And then we did the same again in 1998. Julian Bond comes back I've got an even worse tie. Harry Belafonte gets an honorary doctorate in 1998 and unveils this plaque in the Students' Union building, which is both to his to commemorate his visit, but also that of his friend, Martin Luther King. And then in the renovations of the building, the plaque was lost. No one knows where it is. So the curation of this legacy has been extremely uneven. Okay, but the good news is now these things are being consolidated, being brought together in Freedom City 2017, which, you know, I really love the idea of, because it has artistic elements, creative elements, it has an academic archival curatorial element, it has statuary, but most of all, it's dedicated to trying to perpetuate King's message, not just in Newcastle, but the lessons of his life. In Newcastle, he talked very eloquently in the impromptu speech about the great problems of war, racism, and poverty. And although there are many things we'd like to add, or perhaps should add, to that list of global toxins afflicting our world today, you know, it'd be hard-pressed to say that they're still not three great problems. And what he was calling for was for people of goodwill to rise to the challenges posed by those problems, to join together to try to confront them. He was very fond of talking about what he called the moral arc of the universe. The moral arc of the universe is long, but it bends towards justice. And because of his personal faith, he assumed that ultimately God's design for the world was that freedom, justice, respect for difference, equality would ultimately prevail. But he was a pragmatic realist in terms of politics, and he wanted to mobilize people to put some pressure on that arc, to shorten its curvature so that it would hasten the day, whereas he was very fond of saying, quoting from the prophet Amos, you know, justice would rain like water and righteousness like a mighty stream, something like that. It's a very familiar phrase that he used. But I think one of the things that I really like about Freedom City is the fact that it simultaneously wants to honor a moment in time, but it doesn't want to freeze it in time. It wants to use it productively as a springboard to further activism and action in the Northeast and more globally. And on that note, I shall leave it.